these interviews will run a little bit before the performance, I think, tonight, or I don't know what they're gonna do with them, but.
Can't step out, one second. If I could have you shift a little bit further over. Like further this way.
Okay.
Shift a little bit closer here. Like that, and then I'll move this.
Yeah, yeah. Can you hear her? Yeah. My mom and two siblings.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
The big tall guy's your sibling?
Yeah, my younger siblings.
Younger?
Yeah.
So you were born in Cuba?
Yeah, I was born and raised in Cuba and I moved here when I was
16.
So. 16? Yeah.
All right, we're all set. Yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Rachel, welcome to Carnegie Hall. It's a great pleasure to have you here.
It's yes, a huge honor for me to be here. Thank you.
You've been to New York before.
Yes.
So unlike some of the smaller artists that I've been interviewing today, you're not as impressed with the big buildings as they are.
Yeah. It's always, you know, surprising how beautiful the city is.
Yeah. So you were born in Cuba. Tell me a little bit about your early years.
Yeah, I was born and raised in Cuba and I moved to the States when I was 16 years old. And I began my journey in classical music when I was 7 years old with piano. And then I switched to classical guitar because in Cuba sometimes we didn't have electricity. So my mother told me, you know, you should pick up the guitar because she wanted me to perform at church. So that's our main goal, you know, to, you know, expand the gospel of Christ through music. So she wanted me to perform at church, but she said, if there's no power light, how can you play the piano? So, or a keyboard. So pick up the guitar, you can travel around with the instrument and you can pluck some, you know, chords. I didn't want to pick up the guitar because I said, oh, it's too ordinary. Everyone can play the guitar. But then I was so like wrong about that because classical guitar is way different than pop music. So, and then that's how I started with music, you know, and that's the main reason why I keep doing music to, you know, praise the Lord.
And how many years had you played the piano before you decided that you couldn't do it if there was no electricity?
No. So in Cuba, at the age of 10, you are too old to continue as a pianist. So you gotta choose another instrument as your main instrument. Because I applied to the School of Arts when I was 10, and I began with piano when I was 7. And then I graduated from that school at the age of 14, so, and then continued as a classical guitarist when I moved here, so.
And why did you pick guitar? Was that your choice or?
It was my mother's choice. Yeah. Yeah, she's the reason why I pick up the guitar and then I fall in love with the instrument. So I'm very grateful that she did it for me.
I was gonna say it might've been your mom's choice, but it seems like she knew what she was doing.
Yeah, she knew, yeah.
Because you developed an affinity for it and, but it's such a difficult instrument.
It is. It's very difficult to master the guitar. So that's why there's very few like good guitarists because it sounds like easy, but you gotta, it's just like the piano, you gotta play with the harmony and melody at the same time. And then the fretboard is very hard to sight read sometimes because you have so many options in the fretboard. So you don't know which G or which F you're gonna pick up, you know, right at the moment. So you gotta kind of go through the process of learning the music.
Well, I'm not a musician, but I studied music enough to learn that in music, nothing is easy.
Mm-hmm.
I was telling the story earlier about a video I saw a long time ago of Pablo Casals, and he was giving a master class to a college kid at Harvard University. And they started with the Bach suite, in, mm-hmm. I believe in C minor. And the opening is just a C minor descending scale. And the kid kept playing, and Casals stopped him. No, we have to study that scale. And the kid, by the way, whose name was Yo-Yo Ma, was looking a little bit, you know, I mean, not just the scale. Maybe I'm interpreting it a little wrong, but they worked for 10 minutes on the descending scale. You must play it with feeling and
of course.
So it's more than just notes.
Yeah, making music, just not playing automatically like a machine, you know, phrasing the music.
So how old were you again when you started guitar?
I was 10 years old.
10 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you've loved it ever since. And
yeah.
The beginning, when you're beginning the guitar or any instrument, it's so difficult.
It is.
What kept you going?
Especially when you're a kid, all you want to do is play outside, especially in Cuba, that we go around in the neighborhood and we play. And then I had to do homework, you know, regular school homework, math, geography, you know, Spanish in Cuba, and then plus doing theory, musicology, practice your instrument. And I was very hyper when I was a little girl, so I didn't want to practice at all, so my mom had to, you know, put me, you know, to practice. But yeah, it kept me, you know, the passion for Christ too, so I can, you know, share the gospel through music. So that's one of the main reasons why I kept doing music. One, I love it, and second, you know.
And so you moved to the U.S. when you were 16?
When I was 16, yeah.
And you began studying with a teacher?
Yeah, I met my previous professor, Rafael Padron. He's also a Cuban. I met him when I recently moved from Cuba. I went to a conservatory where he was, you know, teaching. And then he was my professor for 11 years. And then I went to the University of Miami. I did my bachelor's, master, and artist diploma with him. And then I was blessed enough to apply at Eastman with Dr. Nicholas Galouzis, which is one of the greatest blessings that I have. So he's my current professor at Eastman.
Tell me a bit about the Frost School. That's a wonderful town. And you were there for the 4 years?
I was there for six, four for bachelor's, two for master's, and one for artist diploma. So yeah, I spent quite a lot of time over there, but it was amazing. Yeah, they have such a good program for classical musicians, and then the guitar program is building up very quickly. So yeah, I was fortunate enough to be there.
Now, in your years at Frost, what kind of repertoire were you performing?
Well, a lot of repertoire, and I did a lot of chamber music. Because sometimes as a classical guitarist, we used to perform by ourselves all the time, but I always, being encouraged by my professors to do chamber music, because you can learn from other instruments, especially from woodwind, that they have to, you know, use their breathing technique in order to produce a sound. Sometimes when you're a pianist or a violinist or a plug instrument as a guitarist, you don't need air to produce a sound. Sometimes when you finish performing, you say, why am I out of breath? Because you haven't taken a breath in for 4 minutes. So, you know, playing and collaborating with other instruments was my main, you know, experience over there.
Really? And what kind of chamber music calls for a guitar?
Well, I did Piazzolla, I did Vivaldi, I did Bach, I did, many other composers that, you know, that wrote for a guitar and arrangements for guitar.
Did you do any of the Bach lute concertos?
Oh, no, but I did some other stuff with a cellist, and I also did the Faya with a cellist, and then a percussionist, and then other Brazilian music, percussion and cello as well, so I love that.
Yeah, I love the Vivaldi lute concertos.
Yeah.
One in particular, number five.
Yeah, and I did the D major concerto with Vivaldi, so ba-da-bum, ba-da-bum, boom, 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 ba-da-bum, ba-da-bum, boom, 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 yeah.
And the second, is that the one where the second movement has a... That one. That's my very favorite piece of all, actually.
Oh, for real?
It's a wonderful piece.
Yeah, it's kind of short, but it's beautiful, yeah.
There's something magical about it. It used to be the theme song, quote unquote, for a late night radio program in Boston when I was growing up, and it would always start with that piece, and I never forgot it. I still listen to it.
Yeah, it's just beautiful, and it's very fun to play it.
Yeah. And then you were off to Eastman, where you are now.
Yeah, I love it there.
And you're getting a PhD there.
My DMA, actually.
DMA.
Yeah, DMA, which is not that intellectual, like,
it's a performance degree.
Performance
it's like
degree.
A doctorate in
doctorate
performance.
Doctorate in performance, yeah.
And what pieces are you working on for that?
Well, I have been doing a lot of stuff. I recently did the Giuliani Concerto, which is the one that I'm doing tonight, the second movement.
Which concerto, Ginastera?
Giuliani, Mario Giuliani.
Don't know.
Yeah, an Italian composer from the classical period. And then I'm doing tonight the Siciliana, which is the slow movement. It's just a dance, which is beautiful. And then the first and the third movement are more like upbeat, a little bit faster, but yeah, it's just a beautiful concerto, very demanding, very, very demanding. It's just like Mozart, that it sounds very easy for pianists, sounds easy, but it's very difficult to play, because if you messed up, everyone will notice that you messed up. There's no way that you can hide it.
And it's with the string ensemble?
Yeah.
Well, as we just said, nothing is easy.
Nothing is easy, yeah.
And so you'll soon get your degree.
Hopefully with God's help.
And then what's the future like for
you? Well, I'm praying for management, for a manager to support me, because I don't want to be a professor 100% of the time. I want to perform, I want to travel, and you know, and concertize. So that's my main goal after school, to get a management.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Have you had much experience using social media, like YouTube, to try to get?
I have my social media.
Are you on YouTube?
I'm on YouTube. I have Instagram as well. So, but yeah, I'm praying for that.
Yeah. Well, being a concert guitarist is difficult.
It is.
Because there aren't many who've done it. Obviously, we can name a few.
Mm.
Julian Bream, if you know the name.
Yeah.
Segovia, but you can name them really.
David Russell, Manu Barreco. Yeah.
So it's a challenge.
It is.
But I haven't heard you play, but there's something about you which makes me think that you're going to achieve it. And of course, you're in the city with managers. There's a manager on every block here, so maybe you'll find one.
Who knows? Yeah. I'm knocking on every door and let's see which one is the one for me.
Mm-hmm. Have you been speaking to managers? Have anybody expressed a little bit of interest?
Yeah, Robert Berreta, Opus 3 Management.
Mm-hmm. So, what's the name?
Robert Berreta, I think.
Uh-huh.
I'm not 100% sure if I'm pronouncing their name.
But you're still talking with him?
I just spoke to him this weekend because, yeah, I didn't have the chance to talk to him before. But yeah, at the moment there's nothing available, but I don't lose hope because, you know, I always strive for, you know, the impossible because I have the God of impossible things. So he can open the door for me if he wants to.
Have you put together in your own mind recital programs that you would do?
Yeah.
If someone said to you, well, you're on in Detroit tomorrow night for a full-length recital, do you know what you would do?
Yeah, I just did my last DMA recital at Eastman, October 21st, and I did some Spanish music, plus the concerto, the full Giuliani concerto, and I did a hymn with a wonderful singer as well. So yeah, I'm ready. I think I'm ready. So whether I'm not, who knows, but yeah, I believe that I'm ready to do that.
Good. Well, you have a spark, and I think you'll find somebody to ignite it, and I wish you the best of luck, and
I can't
wait to see you tonight.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure being here.
Thank you very much. I think the pleasure was all mine.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to take a picture. I'm going to get a selfie here.